Welcome back to the show for business owners, your first thousand clients. I'm your host, Mitch Russo, and I've been an entrepreneur, business owner, corporate executive, venture capitalist, and company founder for the last 30 years. And if you are just joining us for the first time, the mission of my show is simple: to uncover your potential and guide you to realizing it and provide you with the tools and the wisdom to get your own company to 1,000 clients and beyond. Today, something different from our usual type of guest. I'm interviewing a gentleman who's going to make a significant impact on your life. No matter what you think about diet and food, this next guest is going to change that forever. He's a renowned cardiologist, a New York Times bestselling author, and medical researcher. During his 40-year career in medicine, he had performed over 10,000 heart surgeries and developed life-saving medical technology, and is the former president of the American Heart Association. Now, with all that success, you'd think he would have been content. But something wasn't right. People were coming to him with their internal organs in terrible shape, with autoimmune diseases, severe allergies, and worse. In other countries, many of these conditions didn't even exist. A simple thought turned into a big question. One day, a patient who was denied surgery because his heart was so occluded actually came back and explained that a new diet and supplement program dramatically improved his almost fatal heart condition while losing 45 pounds of fat. My guest was skeptical, but tests proved he really had. How could that happen? This doctor knew supplements don't work. Well, down the rabbit hole he went, and he never looked back. He quit his job and opened a wellness center, focusing entirely on healthy eating as the solution to all that ails us humans. Then wrote two critically acclaimed books on the subject. His most recent, The Plant Paradox, reached number one on the New York Times bestseller list. Let's welcome Dr. Stephen Gundry to the show. Welcome, Dr. Gundry.
Thanks for having me on. Appreciate it.
Absolutely. You know, I have to tell you, I am so excited about your work because this is this thing that has driven humanity, food, basically all of existence. And for some reason, as you've pointed out in your book, as we get older, we seem to wear out this body, maybe even faster than we should. So I was thrilled to start reading your book. And frankly, in the first 20 or 30 pages, my mind exploded. I couldn't believe the things you were saying. But I want to explain one single thing you said that really blew my mind. And I heard you say this in another interview. You said, "I've rarely come across a profoundly healthy vegan." You want to explain that?
Yeah, that's actually true. You know, I was a professor at Loma Linda University, which is a vegetarian institution, for many years. And in my practice currently, I do see a lot of vegans and vegetarians. And it's so, so unusual to actually meet a vegan who either actually has good health or on their blood tests isn't just a giant walking ball of inflammation. And it's really because we've forgotten that plants were here first, and as strange as it may seem, do not want to be eaten. they actually have a life. And they not only don't want to be eaten, but they don't want their babies eaten, their seeds. And the amazing thing about plants is that they can't run and they can't hide and they can't fight, but they're chemists of incredible ability. So they use chemical warfare on their predators, us. And we've forgotten or really have ignored the effect that plants can have on us trying to protect themselves.
Well, you know, that's not a new concept, the idea that plants are alive and that they're there to protect themselves. And I've heard that before, but I think to me the part that blew my mind really was the fact that there are certain types of plants, as you said, evolved to create poisons to destroy the human entity because, after all, they're the predator. Can you explain a little bit about that?
Yeah. Again, we've evolved actually from tree shrews. And so we've been used for 40 million years to be eating primarily the leaves of trees and fruits in those trees. And we've actually gotten used to these chemical proteins in plants called lectins. And our immune system has actually been educated by the bugs that live in our gut, the microbiome, that we know these lectins, we know these plants, they're no big deal, we've known them for millions of years, and we can kind of chill out, not get excited about them. But fast forward to 10,000 years ago when agriculture started, and all of a sudden we started eating and interacting with two completely foreign set of plants and their lectins. One is the grasses, and seeds of grasses like wheat, rye, oats, barley, just as an example. And we had never interacted with the lectins of grasses. We're not horses or cows or elephants. And the lectins in grasses are totally foreign to the bacteria in our gut. And our bacteria had not evolved to handle these. The second thing we began eating is beans. And beans, interestingly enough, cannot be consumed raw. You could actually eat 5 raw kidney beans, and it will coagulate your blood and kill you in about 5 minutes. Hmm. Your listeners probably know the famous espionage poison ricin, the white powder we send to our elected officials, and probably a lot of ricin going around right now. But anyhow, ricin is the lectin of the castor bean, and only a couple of molecules of ricin will actually kill you. So the point of all this is plants arm their babies to make their predators ill or not feel good or not thrive. And the idea is that a smart predator will say, you know, every time I eat these things, I'm not doing well and I'm going to go somewhere else. The fascinating thing in my research at Yale University as an undergraduate was in human evolutionary biology. And most of us don't realize that up until agriculture, humans were actually very tall creatures. We stood over 6 feet tall, men and women. And our brains were actually 15% bigger than they are today. And everybody goes, well, wait, we were very small people and now we're getting bigger. Well, that's actually not true. By agriculture, 2,000 years into agriculture, 8,000 years ago, we had shrunk to 4'10", all because we began eating these plants that we had never eaten before. Now, if you think about it, from a plant standpoint, having you be a smaller predator is a lot better than a bigger predator because you'll eat less.
Of course.
And one of the things I like to point out to people, we've, up until the last generation, have always assumed that Asians, as a general rule, are very short people. And we just felt that they were genetically short. But in the last generation, we've seen that Asians have rapidly caught up with Westerners in height. And it's because the traditional Asian diet was primarily grains and legumes, pulses. And as the Western diet has taken over around the world, they've actually lessened that portion of their diet. And so the lectins in these plants were keeping them short. And now that they've been gradually reduced, they've shot up to their, quote, normal height. So they're not small people at all. The plants were keeping them small.
Hmm. So interesting. Now, Dr. Gundry, I mean, we evolve, people evolve. After 10,000 years, has our body not gotten used to these lectins that are in things like tomatoes and peppers and cucumbers?
Well, I'm glad you brought that up. So none of us in America are from America. We're European, Asian, or African. Believe it or not, even Native Americans are from Asia. So there are actually no Native Americans. Sorry about that. So we never encountered a plant from the Americas with its lectins until 500 years ago when Columbian trade started. And getting to know a new lectin in 500 years is like speed dating in evolution. and I don't think it can be done. And the problem is, a lot of our most treasured plants and vegetables are American, and we shouldn't be eating them. Example, the nightshade family. Potatoes, eggplant, tomatoes, peppers, even goji berries are actually from America. And then the squash family, things like zucchini and pumpkins and cucumbers. And then the American beans, peanuts and cashews are actually beans. The cashew is actually a part of the poison ivy family.
Wow.
And then the American seeds, pumpkin seeds, chia seeds, and sunflower seeds. There's actually two human studies that show that chia seeds promote inflammation. And then there's the American grains and pseudo-grains, corn and quinoa. So these are actually all very foreign to us and incredibly modern to us. And I'm always reminded that, for instance, the Italians didn't eat tomatoes for 200 years after their native son brought them back because they knew how deadly they were. And to this day, Italians always peel and de-seed their tomatoes before they make sauce because the peels and the seeds have the majority of the lectins.
Interesting.
Also, yeah, go to a grocery store and buy a glass jar of Italian bell pepper strips, red pepper strips, and you'll notice that there aren't any peels and seeds because they've been removed. Even the Native Americans who use chili peppers always roasted their chilies and peeled them and de-seeded them. In fact, you can prove this at the grocery store by opening a can of green chilies and you will find no peels and seeds because that's where the lectins were and traditional cultures have been removing them. So we've been inundated with a lot of foods that we just shouldn't be eating. And the thing that's impressed me in my career for the last 15 years is these seemingly harmless foods are the cause of almost all the ailments that afflict us. And I did not want to believe this.
That's a huge statement. This is unbelievable.
Yeah.
So these foods are, if you say that again, I think it will sink in. They're responsible for everything that ails us?
Everything that ails us, I think, can be traced back in one way or another to lectins hacking our immune system or hacking through the wall of our gut and either getting into us as foreign particles or, as I talk about in the plant paradox, allowing some bacterial particles called LPSs that actually incredibly excite and inflame our immune system. You know, people talk about inflammation, and that inflammation is the root cause of all disease, and I completely agree with that. But the problem is, where is the inflammation coming from? It doesn't just happen. And so, luckily, I've had thousands of people who have volunteered to let me take a lot of blood out of them every 3 months and send them to labs around the country looking for why inflammation starts. And as we started taking away these seemingly innocent foods, then we saw that, in fact, people's inflammation went away. And your chronic case of sinusitis is caused, believe it or not, because we produce mucus to trap lectins. Lectins are proteins that seek out sugar molecules. They're sometimes called sticky proteins. And one of the first lines of defense against lectins is the mucus that we make in our nose and mouth and sinuses. And it acts as a barrier to trap the lectins. And I get a kick out of the fact that if you eat spicy food, your nose starts running. Mm. And it's even got a fancy medical term called gustatory rhinorrhea.
Yeah.
But what's happening is you're producing more mucus because your body has sensed literally a lectin attack, and you're trying to grab them before they get into you.
That's amazing. That is truly amazing. And you know, what I want to do is slow this down just a little bit, because we've covered a lot of ground here. And I've read your book, so I can fill in the gaps, but I don't think others can. Let me go back a step here. So if we eat these vegetables, which you claim are really fruits because they have seeds. So again, the cucumber, the tomato, the bell peppers, the zucchini, these have this substance called lectins, which are harmful to humans.
Everyone.
Right. Yep. But help me understand why we can eat them, enjoy them, feel great afterwards, and not suffer these dire effects that you talk about in the book.
Well, we have a selection of patients who I call my canaries. And you may remember, if you're old enough, that coal miners would carry canaries in a cage into coal mines because they couldn't smell the lethal gases. And the canaries, because they had a high metabolic rate, they would be affected much quicker. And so if the canaries stopped chirping, they ran for it. Well, I have a number of patients who literally, a simple exposure to these sorts of compounds causes them to, for instance, have a migraine headache or have a burst of rheumatoid arthritis or lupus or depression. And they react almost instantaneously. So I call them my canaries. Now, most people don't have that immediate reaction, but we can actually measure that reaction in blood tests. And it may take 10, 20, 30, or 40 years for that ongoing reaction to manifest in the form of arthritis, in the form of heart disease, hypertension, diabetes, memory loss, Parkinson's. You choose the condition, and as I show in the plant paradox, there's very good solid research, not only mine, but many others, that implicate plant lectins as behind each of the diseases that I've just mentioned.
That makes a lot of sense, particularly what I was impressed about in the book is the research that you've done, the actual studies that you've conducted on lectins and how they affect people in this way. But the part that was most surprising was that you could take somebody with 40 years of damage and in a matter of months reverse most of that. How does that work?
Well, the amazing thing is we regenerate about 90% of all the cells in our body every 3 months. In fact, our skin turnover is even quicker. It takes about 6 weeks to completely regenerate your skin. So every 3 months, you actually do a complete turnover of almost all the cells in your body. And if you stop harming those new cells and you give those new cells the building blocks to be a very good functioning cell, we actually see what, again, I wouldn't have believed any of this 17 years ago, but I get to see it every day in the office. And not only do we see it by people telling us they canceled their hip replacement or their knee replacement or they're moving their hands again because that were frozen from arthritis, but the difference is this could be a placebo effect, but we can see it on the blood work that all of these inflammation markers or markers of autoimmune disease have completely returned to normal.
So if the blood shows that the systems have returned to normal and the symptoms themselves go away, then does that mean that the disease is gone?
Yeah, it means the disease is gone. Now, do you have a propensity for those diseases? Yeah, you absolutely do. And I just 3 weeks ago returned from giving a paper at the International Congress on polyphenols, and that's a whole other subject. But long story short, we had a group of patients who we would remove lectins from them and look at the stickiness on the inside of their blood vessels. We can actually do this, and we can look at how flexible their blood vessel wall is. And we remove lectins, and the stickiness goes away, and the flexibility returns. But then in 57 patients, they decided to reintroduce lectins, either because they forgot or they decided they were feeling so well, they might as well start branching out. And in all 57 people, their blood vessels got sticky again, and their blood vessels got stiff. And when this was pointed out to them, we took lectins away, and lo and behold, their blood vessels got slippery again, and their blood vessels got flexible. So we can actually watch this happening.
So not only is it confirmed in blood tests, but in observation, medical observation, using medical technology, what you're basically saying is that you can see the effect of lectins even in a localized area over a short period of time.
Correct. Yep.
So what the thing about that is, I mean, in a way, that's kind of good news and bad news.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, for someone like me, I mean, I love Mexican food. I love Thai food and spicy foods. So does this mean that's the end of those types of foods for me forever?
No, there's absolutely ways around this. Interestingly, most cultures who have used peppers and spicy foods ferment their peppers. So, for instance, like Tabasco sauce is fermented. Sriracha sauce is fermented. And fermentation is a time-honored way of letting bacteria and fungi actually eat the lectins in the food. So it's the lectin content dramatically decreases. The other thing you do is you peel or de-seed tomatoes or peppers and you eliminate the lectin problem. Lastly, a pressure cooker is one of the greatest devices designed by whoever to destroy lectins. Pressure cooking destroys all lectins except the lectin gluten. And interestingly enough, gluten happens to be a lectin. It's actually a minor lectin. There's far worse. But it's interesting that there are ways to get rid of these things. Speaking of Thai food, 4 billion people use rice as their staple.
Mm-hmm.
And yet 4 billion people go to the trouble of taking the hull off of rice and eating their rice white. And that seems kind of dumb because everybody knows how good brown rice is for you. Well, in fact, the hull of the grains have the lectins. And these clever Asians for thousands of years have been taking the hull away. I like to study traditional cultures and see what they do to eliminate lectins. For instance, the Incas actually had 3 detoxification processes to get the lectins out of quinoa. They soaked it for 48 hours, then they fermented it, they let it rot, and then they cooked it. And it's not on the package directions.
Interesting. So there are maybe intuitive ways that ancient cultures have used forever to eliminate the problem, and probably with nothing other than the understanding that if I eat this, I get sick. If I do this to my food, I feel well. It's all it took, basically.
Yeah, that's actually all it took. I'll give you a personal example. My grandmother on my mother's side was French, and she taught my mother to always peel and de-seed tomatoes before she sliced them and served them. And it wasn't until I went to Yale that I actually had a sliced tomato with peels and seeds, and I thought it was the oddest thing that I'd ever had. And, you know, looking back throughout my career at Yale, I suffered from sinusitis nearly constantly. Hmm. And of course, I didn't know any better that perhaps it was all those tomatoes with peels and seeds I was eating for the first time. Mm-hmm. But I'll give you another example. The French banned corn as unfit for human consumption in 1900 because of actually an outbreak of mental retardation in northern Italy when the Italians adapted corn as their grain of choice. And to this day, you actually, it's rare to see corn on a menu in France. And they actually decreed that corn should be fed to pigs to fatten them for slaughter, which makes a lot of sense.
Well, sure. The corn not only fattens the pigs, it fattens the people. So
yeah, exactly.
So now I get it. But since you mentioned corn, I want to go down this path for a moment. You also mentioned in the book that eating traditional protein, such as chicken, maybe even beef, and particularly the standard white and black cow beef, is also not healthy for humans to consume. Explain why.
Yeah, there's, you know, I grew up in Omaha, Nebraska, and Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and, you know, where meat is king and cheese is king. And it really makes me sad to tell people that, as a general rule, animal protein is not our friend. And we can talk about that in a second. But also, I found through my research that about 2,000 years ago, Northern European cows suffered a genetic mutation, and they started to make a protein in their milk called casein A1. The normal protein is called casein A2. It's present in Southern European cows, goats, sheep, and water buffalo. And unfortunately, the casein A1 cows are hardier and they give more milk, so that almost all cows in the world, including ours, are the wrong breed of cow. They're the black and white Holstein primarily. And what others have found, and I have confirmed, is that the casein A1 protein is a lectin-like protein that actually attacks our pancreas. And people who think that milk gives them mucus, or that milk, that they're lactose intolerant, interestingly enough, it's actually the casein A1 that's the problem. And so when we switch them over to like goat yogurt or goat cheese or sheep cheese, or cheeses in general from France, Italy, or Switzerland, or water buffalo, they don't have any of these reactions. And we can actually see this in blood work that we do on people. So back to beef. Most of our cows, pigs, and lamb in this country are fed corn and soybeans. And I didn't want to believe this, but when you feed these animals unnatural lectins that they're not used to eating, the lectins will actually be incorporated into their flesh. And in the book, I talk about a number of people who their organic free-range chicken was the cause of their autoimmune disease. So that's number one. But I'm infamous or famous for doing a lot of xenotransplantation work, which is getting one species to accept another and transplant. I did a lot of pig to baboon heart transplant in my day. And there is a sugar molecule that lines the blood vessels of beef, pork, and lamb that we react to with a immune response to our own blood vessels and attack our own blood vessels. And it also, this sugar molecule is used by cancer cells to evade our immune system. And they use it as a cloaking device. So that actually explains why every study that's ever been done suggests that there's a strong association with red meat eating and cancer incidence and heart disease. And it has nothing to do with red meat. It has to do with this crazy sugar molecule. The sugar molecule is not present in chicken, fish, or shellfish. And it also is one of the reasons that chicken consumption and shellfish consumption has less association with cancer and heart disease. It's all because of this dumb sugar molecule.
So if you stopped eating beef and continue to eat other meats, does that keep you safer?
It keeps you safer from heart disease, but here's the spoiler alert. I spend a lot of time in the book talking about longevity and what we know and don't know about, you know, staying young. And there's sadly very, very convincing evidence that animal proteins, specific amino acids in animal proteins, and that includes fish and chicken, turn on an aging receptor that's called mTOR, T-O-R. And this receptor actually senses nutrient availability. And it's very sensitive to certain amino acids that are far more present in animal protein than in plant proteins. And as much as, you know, I hate to say it coming from Nebraska and Wisconsin, the less animal protein you eat, the less this receptor is turned on, and we can actually measure the downstream expression of this in what's called insulin-like growth factor 1. And we've taken animal protein away from people, and their insulin-like growth factor 1s plummet.
So let's go back to the first statement I made when we began talking today. I asked you about vegans, and I wondered why. Because, I mean, this has been said before, take meat out of the diet and you'll keep people healthier. But yet you said vegans are not healthy.
Right, because vegans in this country are what I call pasta, bean, and grain-atarians. a vegan should be eating vegetables, and none of those are vegetables. And the interesting thing is that the vegetables that vegans are eating are actually not vegetables at all. They're fruits. So the nightshades, the tomatoes, the peppers, the eggplant, the cucumbers, the squashes, the zucchini noodles, they're all lectin-containing fruits from America. And the amazing thing is, when I take those away from vegans, they get better. In fact, I did a podcast with quite a famous vegan author. She has a best-selling book. And to her credit, she said, you know, your book was very intriguing to me because I'm a vegan and I, you know, really feel like I have thriving health following this diet compared to what I used to do, which was the standard American diet. But she said, I was intrigued. So I put myself on the plant paradox for a month before we set up this interview. And she said, I got to tell you, you were right. And I did not think I could feel better. But in fact, I feel lighter. I have far less feelings of funny things going on in my gut that I just thought was normal. And you're right. So, you know, she says, I'm really altering, you know, my vegan diet. I'm still going to be a vegan, but now I'm going to take away these plants that don't like me. The other important thing for vegans and vegetarians to realize is that they have to get a source of long-chain omega-3 fatty acids. And most of us get that from fish or fish oil, but of course vegans and most vegetarians won't do that. And they've been told erroneously that flaxseed, which is a short-chain omega-3, will be converted to the long-chain omega-3 DHA that we need for our brain. But in fact, we don't. And my vegans and vegetarians are profoundly deficient in DHA. Now, the good news for them is that you can take DHA from algae sources now. But the really scary thing for vegans is that your brain is actually about 70% fat, and half of that fat is DHA. And so there's studies in vegans that show that they unfortunately have smaller brains and they have smaller areas of memory centers, the hippocampus. And it's all because they're deficient in this omega-3 fat that your brain is made out of.
And is this something that you can verify with medical testing?
Yes, we check what's called the omega-3 RBC index every 3 months in all of our patients. And I've never met a vegan with they all have dangerously low omega-3 indexes. And when we supplement them with algae DHA, they all come up to normal. But I've yet to meet a vegan with a normal RBC omega-3 index.
Interesting. Well, I will definitely make sure my vegan friends listen to this interview because it's important. This episode is brought to you by OscarHamilton.com, who edit and produce all of our podcast episodes. They have a great range of services for podcasters at all levels. They can help you set up your podcast, but also offer a couple of excellent services to help you edit your shows and get them up with great show notes. Check them out at OscarHamilton.com. One other thing I wanted to ask about. In the book, you talk about being allowed to have 8 ounces of animal protein per day. Explain how that fits into the diet.
Well, we start people with 8 ounces, but if you'll notice, as we go along, we rapidly take you down and down and down. We only need 20 grams of protein per day. That's all we need. And the book really explains how those calculations came about. They're my calculations, but also confirmed by Dr. Walter Longo, who's the longevity researcher at USC. And we need very, very little animal protein. So what's 20 grams look like? That's 2.5 eggs. That's a small can of tuna. That's 1 scoop of protein powder. That's 1 Quest bar or protein bar. That's 3 medium-sized shrimp, and that's 1/2 deck of cards of salmon. In 24 hours, that's all we need, and that's not much. And so one of the things that's impressive to me is we are over-proteinized in this country, and there's 2 very large studies, worldwide studies, that have now concluded that animal protein is equal to the effect of sugar in promoting obesity and diabetes in the world. And this is one of the things that Adkins did not know. And my first book was bought by Random House, and my editor had done all the Adkins books and all the South Beach books. And what I proposed in that book was the mistake Adkins made. And that is we have no storage system for protein. We use it for wear and tear repair. But we don't waste energy. We're very economical. So we convert excess protein into sugar. And it's called gluconeogenesis. And why we do that? Because we got a great storage system for sugar. It's called fat. And one of the amazing things, I see a lot of high-protein dieters or Atkins dieters, and many of them are diabetic, despite the fact that they're not eating any carbohydrates. They're very faithful. But what they didn't realize is that all that protein was being converted to sugar. And that's one of the reasons I have a problem with the standard paleo diet, which does a lot of smart things, like taking grains and beans away from people. But instead, they replace it with large amounts of meat and animal protein. And really, to think that our ancient ancestors were, you know, dining on a side of a mastodon every day of our lives is rather naive. We subsisted on tubers and leaves, and you know, the occasional scorpion.
Yum.
But yummy. They're actually very good for you.
I'll keep that in mind.
Yeah, if they don't get to you first.
Right. Well, that again is so fascinating. And I want to get back to this one thing about the vegan lifestyle. So if you're saying that if you supplement with DHA and vitamin D, then a vegan lifestyle can be healthy. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, absolutely. And in fact, I'm what I call myself a veg aquarian. I eat mostly vegetables, but more importantly, I eat the oils that come from fruits like olive oil and like avocados. And I personally feel the only purpose of food is to get olive oil into my mouth. But in terms of vegans, I've had the pleasure of working with the cardiologist Gary Murray, who's been tracking the Adventist health study, which has been ongoing for many, many years. And here's the bad news for meat eaters. The Adventists are one of the blue zones. They're some of the longest living people in the world. And the vegan Adventists have the longest lifespan, followed by the vegetarians who don't eat much animal protein but eat cheeses, followed by the cheating Adventists who eat fish, the pescatarians, followed by the real cheaters who add some chicken to their diet. But the really striking thing is, and this agrees with all the animal data, that sadly animal protein is one of the key factors in aging. And I disagree with the author of The Blue Zones, Dan Bruttner. I think he's a great author. But the thing that makes all blue zones the same, he would like you to believe that it's because they eat grains and beans, which is absolutely not true. What unites all of these very different cultures is they have very limited animal protein in their diet. It's a tiny fraction of their diet. And that's what every experimental model confirms, including the model of rhesus monkey aging. So, and, you know, again, it makes me feel sad because I grew up in two meatocentric communities.
Interesting. But you can, if you eat wild fish, you can consume protein that is safer than the traditional farmed meat protein.
Yes, absolutely. In fact, one of the conundrums of everything that I've just told you is there's a village in the south of Italy that I visited last month called Acciaroli. And Acciaroli has become famous. The Blue Zone guy did not know about them. They have the largest percentage of centenarians, people over 100, of any population in the world. About a third of this town's population is over 100. And these guys eat anchovies for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. They eat huge amounts of rosemary. They chew rosemary. They cook with it. They consume large amounts of olive oil. They drink quite a bit of wine. And interestingly enough, almost all of them smoke. And they are like the group that I talk about in the book as well, the Catawbans, this Pacific Island nation, who follow much the same process, except they eat a lot of taro root, and they smoke like fiends, and they live into their 90s with no medical care, and they've never had a case of heart disease or stroke documented in these people. So the folks in Italy are being studied extensively because they eat a lot of little tiny fish, which are basically huge amount of omega-3 fats.
Mm, Interesting. So clearly, I mean, there's the indicator right there in real life. Without the scientific studies, here's a population that focuses on the omega-3s from anchovies, which are wild. I don't think you can farm anchovies.
You can't. That's correct.
And of course, the olive oil, I mean, I think you stated in the book that the Italians drink about a liter a day of olive oil. That's amazing.
Yeah, they drink a liter a week, so that's 12 to 14 tablespoons a day.
Wow.
And the Cretes do this, some of the oldest living people. The Sardinians do this. There was an amazing study that was done in Spain that was completed about a year ago. They took 65-year-old people, and they divided them into three groups. And the original part of the study was to look at memory. And they had people eat a Mediterranean diet. One group was made to use a liter of olive oil per week. The second group was given the equivalent amount in raw walnuts in terms of calories. And the third group ate a low-fat Mediterranean diet. And they were followed for 5 years. The olive oil group and the walnut group had not only preserved memory at the end of 5 years, but the olive oil group actually had better memory. The low-fat group had deteriorated memory. But when they started breaking down things, they found that the olive oil group actually lost weight compared to the other two groups, even though they were consuming a liter per week. And the women in the olive oil group had 67% less breast cancer than either of the other two groups. And a new study out of the same study has shown that the incidence of heart disease was lowest in the olive oil and the walnut group and highest in the low-fat Mediterranean diet group.
Yeah, and again, very consistent with so much of what we've heard over the years, and here you are pulling all of this together. Now, before we get off this topic of fruits and vegetables, I have one quick question. If you remove the seeds from, say, a bell pepper, is it then safe to eat that bell pepper, or does it still have the skin?
Great. Yeah, you got to take the skin off of it as well.
I see. Okay.
And that's why, you know, you go to the Hatch Chili Festival in New Mexico, and that's why they're charring their chili peppers and pulling the skin off. They're not doing it for fun.
Right.
This is, you know, and we showed Dr. Oz last week how to peel and de-seed a tomato on his show. So if anybody's interested, they can go to Dr. Oz and go to the July 10th episode where I teach Dr. Oz how to peel and de-seed a tomato.
Cool. Well, I have a feeling a lot of people are going to go see that. It's because we all enjoy the benefits of tomatoes in terms of taste, but not, of course, the danger side of it, which is now at least there's a way to avoid that. That's good to know. So let's move on to a topic which I know is going to be controversial. You say that eating fruit is like eating a bowl of Skittles, that it's pure sugar, pure candy, and it's bad for you.
Yeah, exactly. So here's the deal. Long ago, we only ate fruit once a year in the summer in the jungle. Fruit ripens only once a year, even in the jungle. Great apes only eat fruit once a year. And believe it or not, great apes only gain weight during fruit season. It's the only time they gain weight. Why? Because the sugar in fruit is converted to triglycerides, which are then stored as fat. And it was a good idea for us to eat fruit because we could fatten up for the winter, which was a time of less food, whether it was a dry season or any season or a cold season. Now, what's happened is that we now have 747s that can bring blueberries to Costco in February from Chile. And that's completely unnatural. So one of the things that people should realize is we run a very, very old computer program. In fact, our operating system runs version 1.0. And as your good friend and mine, Tony Robbins, would say, we run version 1.0. And we have to understand what that version understands. So if you're eating blueberries in February, your computer does not think it's February. It thinks it's August. and that it's summer and that you should be storing fat for the winter. The other thing that's happened is that we have bred fruit for sugar content. I was at the Santa Barbara Farmers Market last weekend, and there are organic blueberries for sale that are the size of grapes.
Wow.
And that's not natural. Blueberries are these little bitter things that when I was growing up, you had to put a half a cup of sugar on to make them edible. But we've taken every one of our foods and, you know, supersized it for sugar content. And, you know, we have a honey sweet apple that's the size of a grapefruit. And we eat one apple, not realizing that in 1950, the current apple would be equivalent to about five apples. And so we've lost touch with what fruit was used for, and that was to store fat for the winter. And we eat fruit now at our own peril. Now, can you have it? Sure, you can have it in the summer when it's grown locally in organic conditions, but there's no human need for fruit. Just ask an Eskimo. They eat no fruit in their traditional diet. And there's never been a case of diabetes or heart disease or cancer in a native Eskimo that eats their diet of blubber. So fruit has a lot of bad side effects. The American Cancer Society a few years ago did a five-year study of women with breast cancer looking for breast cancer recurrence. And one group was advised to eat 5 to 7 servings of fruits and vegetables a day, and the other group was not advised to do that. Now, when people are told to eat fruits and vegetables, what do they eat? Well, of course, they eat fruits because it tastes better. And the vegetables they choose to eat are actually not vegetables. They're fruits. They're tomatoes and peppers and squashes and zucchini. So, and cucumbers. And what they found at the end of 5 years was that the group who ate the 5 servings of fruits and vegetables actually had a higher recurrence rate of breast cancer than the people who were not told to do that. American Cancer Society. Yeah.
Wow. That's amazing. So I get what you say. It's the fact that we've basically distorted fruit into something that now is saleable. We do this to fruit so that we could sell more of it, not because it's more nutritious or because it's good for us.
Right. Remember, two-thirds of our tongue is sweet receptors, sweet taste buds. Mm-hmm. And we did that because it was incredibly advantageous for us to like the sweet taste of fruit and eat lots and lots of it, because if we did that, we'd be fat enough to make it through the winter. And we've never reprogrammed our brain. We've never had an upgrade. And so when sugar, a sweet taste, hits our tongue, our brain says, oh my gosh, you just won the fruit tree lottery, and this is not going to last very long, and you better eat some more. And so this just constantly drives us. And remember, the Department of Agriculture, who makes recommendations of what we're supposed to eat, is in the business of selling agricultural products.
Of course.
It's not in the business of taking care of our health.
Yep, that's so true. In fact, the thing about many of what these so-called governing bodies tell us, the problem is their studies are sponsored by the very companies that are producing the type of products that we've been talking about today.
Absolutely, right. Yep.
So it makes it suspect to begin with. Well, I have to tell you, Dr. Gundry, this has been so fascinating to me. If I could, I'd like to see if I could summarize this. What it comes down to is that if you stay away mostly from most grains, and I think you said white rice was okay, or did you not say white rice is okay?
Well, if you're going to have rice, I recommend white basmati rice from India. Mm-hmm. It's actually a much more resistant starch than American basmati rice. They're a different strain. The other option is to cook it and then cool it, put it in the refrigerator, and then reheat it. It actually turns it into more of a resistant starch.
Really? Okay.
Yeah.
So that's a good trick, a good tip for those of us who love rice. So if we stay away from the other grains, which, and I personally know how bad gluten is for me personally, and we stay focused on eating less and less animal protein, more and more vegetables that are not actually fruits, then we could regain and retrieve our lost health. Is that right?
That's absolutely right.
Now, if someone is listening to this and says, oh my goodness, this is a pretty radical shift in what I'm doing right now. If they were to start in this direction and over time move more and more of these seeded vegetables out of their diet and start lessening the amount of animal protein they're eating, will that allow the gut bacteria to still repopulate, or do they have to completely stop in order to do that?
No, it will repopulate, but it'll be slower. Interesting, there's several very good studies, one that I reference in the book, that 3 days of following what I call the quick start cleanse will actually totally change the gut population in your gut from bad bugs to good bugs. But the minute you go away from that, the bad bugs return and the good bugs leave. It's actually fascinating research.
Interesting. So in a way, I think what I'm hearing you say is that there's no cheating.
Yeah, the less you cheat, the better. Everybody cheats. The less you cheat, the better.
Absolutely. Well, for those of my listeners who have never even heard of you or don't have a clue about what we've been talking about today and think it's all kind of weird and crazy, I think what I would suggest is that they would get the book, The Plant Paradox, and that can get them started on understanding your philosophy. And for anybody who reads that book, I think what you'll start to understand is that when someone like Dr. Gundry makes these claims, he didn't just make this stuff up. It comes from clinical trials. It comes from real world life experience working directly with patients. So even my wife, who was super critical of any of these fads, is now understanding that, wait a minute, if this guy is really doing it and proving it in his clinic, then maybe there's something to all this. So I would highly recommend that we get the Plant Paradox book, read it. And one other question. You talk a little bit about the fruit and the fact that it's bad for you, but you also mentioned that polyphenols are important and good for you. So what do you do about that? Sounds like a paradox.
Well, it is a paradox, the plant paradox. What I like people to do if they got to have their fruit is get out your juicer and juice your fruit, throw away the juice, and then then take the pulp that's left behind, which has all the polyphenols that you're looking for, and then mix that in with coconut yogurt, or just put it in your smoothie. I've got several smoothie recipes to do. Or, you know, shameless plug, you can go to my website, GundryMD.com, and get yourself some Vital Reds or Primal Plants, and you can get all the polyphenols you need that way.
Okay, good. Good to know. And I'll make sure that the links to both the book and to your site are at the bottom of the show page. Dr. Gundry, I can't tell you what a pleasure it's been to have this chance to talk with you and really understand this diet. And more important, understand the effect that you personally can have on our planet. I believe that we're all here to change the world in one way or another. And it's so clear that in doing your work, can change the world in such a wonderful way. Thank you for everything you've done, and thank you again for your time today.
Well, Mitch, thanks for your kind words. I am out to change the world in this way, and it can be done with people like you getting out the message.
We'll talk to you again soon, Dr. Gundry.
Thanks, sir.
You've been listening to Your First 1,000 Clients with your host, Mitch Russo. Go to www.yourfirst1000clients.com for a free guide on how to get 1,000 of your own clients. And if you like this episode, please go to iTunes and subscribe, rate, and review.